morning, everybody.
Good morning.
How many of you came last year? I gave a talk on rain gardens. Okay, so I've got some new material, so hopefully it won't be the same old stuff that you've seen in the past. One thing I'll mention right up front is that if I have your email address, or there's a handout that has my email address on the back, it's a rain garden resources sheet that I've added to, and there are links there that are active if you have a copy of the PDF file. So you don't have to type in these long strings. So I will email a copy of this to anybody that wants one. And if you put your email address over there, or you want to contact me on the back with my email address on the back, I'll send that to you. Also, if you would like a copy of the presentation, I'll create a PDF form of it so that you can also have it, and it'll be in color for you then. So I'll create that after the talk. Probably the weekend I'll work on it. So and that'll be available then also for you if you want a copy of it. How many of you currently, anybody might have a small rain garden in their yard? Oh, you do. Oh, good for you. How big is it? Is it a?
It's probably about as long.
Oh, okay. Oh, good size. Oh, nice.
Yeah, I have it like next to the street where the runoff comes.
Oh, sure. Right.
And it's in front of a creek too. So
uh-huh.
It goes before.
Oh, before the creek, which is good. You want clean water to go
the way
in the creek.
Water runs.
Right. Okay. Very good. Well, I probably should have selected a better topic for this morning. Rain gardens is fine, but the last piece that Chris and I worked on, Chris often gives me my titles. She's good at that. But this one, I cannot speak to this.
Oh, wow.
So this is currently what was going on down there, but you can see why it's so toxic if you look at the oil slick and gasoline slick on the water. So you can imagine what those people are going through. But rain gardens would not solve this,
no.
Period. So not at all. So this morning we want to talk a little bit about rain gardens and their function. We'll talk about what is a watershed. That's where a lot of our water comes from, is in the watershed. What and where the North Carolina River basins are. So we'll have a little discussion about that. Where is Little Alamance Creek watershed? And this is what we contend with in our yards. We're in that watershed. And it's this area that is of interest to the city of Burlington and the EPA, because Little Alamance Creek has been designated as a biologically very inactive. So they want to clean that up. We'll focus on why the focus on Little Alamance Creek. I'll give you an update on the, if you remember, the city had a residential rain garden campaign that they had started. So I'll give you an update on that. I talked to, was in email contact with Bob Patterson, who's the director of water resources here in Burlington. So he gave me just a little update, and I'll update you on that. And then these are some of the projects we'll just mention and talk about. We'll talk a little bit about my rain garden, not a lot. The Cronodal Center rain garden, which sits down below the senior center. There's a big area down there that they put in to capture water. Fairchild rain garden next to the soccer fields out there. There's a huge area, there's a parking lot. All that parking lot water drains into that particular area. I have a couple pictures of that. And then we're going to focus basically on the Arbor Great rain garden, which I hope you've looked at as you walked in. I know some of you came in the back, but we'll do a little walkthrough at the end then and kind of talk about the plants there. So that's basically the agenda for this morning. Any questions to start off? Okay. So what is a rain garden? Well, basically it's a depression that you can create in your yard. It allows the rainwater and runoff to accumulate and collect and then be absorbed into the soil. So it doesn't run directly to the drains that feed into the stream. So, and of course, that sewer system, stormwater sewer system, is quite different than our regular sewage system, as you know. Fits in smaller, large spaces, so based on the design. Offers many ecological benefits for your yard and for the wildlife in and around your yard. It's intended to prevent and control flooding. If you have lots of runoff and running through your yard, it helps control that and filter it as it goes through the yard, and makes maybe a dreary spot that you had to look at even more pleasant to look at. And I hope that's what you have with your rain garden.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
That's a pretty flower.
Okay, good. So how does it work? Well, it enters rain garden through the runoff, and of course that runoff can come from drain system, driveways, a lot of sources. It diverts the runoff from the paved driveway surfaces of roofs. Ponding occurs in the rain garden less than 24 hours. So if it's designed correctly and percolates correctly, you should not have standing water in there beyond 48 hours. Water seeps into the soil over time, which is good, so it gets infiltrated. Any rooted material there, plants that you have in there, will absorb that water and the nutrients, and of course also water comes off because we have evapotranspiration. So any of those plants out there are transpiring water, so it's also giving off water as it absorbs the nutrients. Plants adapted to the wet environments have very fibrous root systems, so there's a lot of lists out there of plants that are well adapted to having their roots or feet wet, if you will. So there's good ample material out there for that. It replenishes the groundwater, so it's not being diverted and directly into the drain, but it's actually infiltrating through the soil in your yard. So here's some of the runoff from the roof. Driveway, if you have a little drippy oil slick or something on the driveway, it will drain in. We have a Rover with something here. And it runs in, of course, and goes in directly into the stream system. So runoff from the street carries pollutants. So some of the runoff, it's pet waste, leaves, fertilizers, motor oil. And Stormwater Smart, which is a group over in Greensboro, and there's a couple brochures up there from them, but they did a study here in Burlington, and it said that 37% of the households in Burlington own dogs. There are 12,874 dogs in Burlington. This was done a few years ago. That means 4,248 pounds of dog poop daily. 1,550 pounds of raw sewage a year, and that's equivalent to almost 78 truckloads of waste. That's just from dogs. So I thought that was kind of interesting to mention since we have an example of what's going on right there. So, so pollutants in the runoff, common pollutants include pesticides. Of course, when you spray them on, you hopefully you look at the weather report, and when you do spray them, they're going to stay there and not be washed off immediately once they're dried. Herbicides, the same way. That's a problem with spraying. And then immediately, if rain comes along, you've got to monitor that and follow all the directions on the use. Fertilizers, so if you fertilize your yard and you have a rain come along right after it, most of that has washed away, hasn't been absorbed. Trash, we have trash coming out. Pet waste, we just mentioned. Automotive fluids include engine oil, coolants, automatic transmission fluid, differential fluid, brake fluid, power steering fluid. All of these potentially can cause, or if you have a leak in those areas, can cause the pollution. Toxic metals like lead, cadmium, mercury, and chromium can occur just from the soil, but also from a lot of times new roofs that are put in. When they first wash, you will get a flush of some of these into the rainwater. So there's some caution with using rain barrels because of that. Once that first flush comes through, hopefully it's clean off the roof, but there's not any evidence that people have suffered because of what's drained off the roof. So rain gardens or rain barrels are still a good option, I think. I usually use it on plant material that's not producing vegetables that we eat, so flowers and so forth, I'll use it there. So here again, showing the functions, if you can't have one of these little sunken areas or you don't have a wet area in the yard that would entertain a rain garden, You could go to rain barrels, and that's another way to capture water coming immediately off the roof and then let it drain slowly across the lawn. So it's also doing some task by cutting down the rapid flow of water that comes off. So rain garden design principles basically handle stormwater at its source. So when you have a storm, it comes off the roof, comes off the driveway, comes off the pavement, that's the source. Decreases the velocity of the water flowing from the driveways or parking lots or other impervious system or surfaces. And it also decreases the water temperature. This is something that you don't hear a lot about, but coming off of a hot roof or draining off of a parking lot, that water is, you know, well over 100 degrees, and it can cause problems. A lot of problem people have with sometimes watering, they have a hose, and the hose will heat up in the sun, and they turn it on and put it on their favorite plants, and bingo, it's over 100 degrees, and you end up with a problem. So again, cooling that off is helpful, particularly when it goes into streams. So a lot of the major construction going on now, they'll have a retention area where water flows in directly off the parking lot. It has a chance to cool before it enters into the stream, because that hot water going into the stream will also kill the invertebrates and so forth in the stream. Keeps water on the soil surface, aiding infiltration. So again, it's allowing that water to infiltrate. Improves water quality before it enters the river, streams, and ditches. So this is one thing we want to do, is clean up that water before it gets to the streams. So pollutants filtered by rain garden. Here are some of the pollutants. We have metals, roofing shingles, oil, grease, automobile fluids. It can remove 43% to 97% of those that might come into a rain garden. Phosphorus, detergents, that's where the detergents, fertilizers, pet waste, 65% to 87%. And then nitrogen, fertilizer, pet waste, organic matter, grass clippings, and so forth, 15% to 92% can be removed if it flows through into a rain garden and is filtered. So the benefits, of course, having a pleasant sight to look at in the front here in this case, and of course at the front of this building, we have a nice entrance way there with a rain garden. It absorbs 30% more rainwater in the runoff than just grass, so it conserves water, helps clean the runoff of pollutants, reduces the potential home flooding, provides a habitat for beneficial wildlife, butterflies, birds, bees. So it's and that's true of the rain garden we have in front. We'll talk more about it. It's a bee-friendly garden. My rain garden is a bee-friendly garden. So bees, butterflies, wasps all visit the flowering plants. Reduces mosquito breeding. So capturing that water so it doesn't stand somewhere. So what about mosquitoes? Well, mosquito eggs need at least 7 days to hatch in standing water. So that's where it's critical to empty things on a weekly basis if you have a bird bath. And you can get rid of a lot of mosquitoes in your area if you just take that action and emptying standing water. Rain garden is not a pond, as I mentioned. It should drain, usually dries out within a day or two, and that's by design, so hopefully that occurs. But the life cycle over here, you can see the eggs are laid on the surface of the water, the larvae hatch, it pupates, and then the adult merges, and then you have the mosquito, the adult that emerges. Our nemesis in our yard is this Asian tagger mosquito, which is characterized by these lines and white stripes. And then here's the yellow fever mosquito, which we do have here, but not much reported of yellow fever or Zika or anything like that currently in our area. So we seem to be okay. So there are 11 basic steps to rain garden planning. And one is call before you dig. So if you're going around sort of trying to find out where in the location you want, it's good to have it marked off first. And then you can start digging and look for a location. Pick a location, measure the drainage rate. And we'll talk a little bit about that, how to measure whether your soil can percolate There's no reason to put a garden in, a rain garden in that depression if the water stays for days. So you do a test early, and we'll talk about that briefly. Determine the rain garden's depth. So depending on the topography in your yard, you may have a deeper rain garden than someone that has a shallow relief to their yard, the topography. So determining that depth is critical on how you start it. Outline the garden location. Do an outline of where it is. You dig in, so you can start digging. Check the drainage rate again. So sometimes after it's dug, you might want to do another test for drainage and percolation. And if it doesn't perk again fast enough, you may have to go a little deeper, or you may have to mix in some sand and gravel at the base to encourage the loss of water more quickly. Or you may have to put in a special medium, which I'll talk about in a minute, that may allow that water to dissipate more quickly. Add native vegetation. So my emphasis is trying to select native plants that you can put into your into the rain garden. Mulch is critical, and we'll talk a little bit about mulching. Water, of course, after you've freshly planted these plants in the rain garden, we haven't had rain, you need to water them to get them established for the first year. And then, of course, at the end, step 11 is maintenance. There is some maintenance with a rain garden. So, and so here's a slide that says, tells us where not to build a rain garden. And here you don't want it within 10 feet of a building foundation. You don't want it near an edge or a steep slope where it would flow out and then you have problems with erosion. So that's a thing to consider. Over utilities, you don't want to dig in an area where you have utilities. And then near existing septic tanks or other tanks in the ground. So that's critical. But where to build is right here in low spots that do not drain well, or that drain well. So you want to make sure that that's the location that you select. And of course, calling 811 will bring those people out free of charge, and they will mark off any electrical lines, or I think they do. Do they do water and
no.
Gas? No.
Not in municipalities.
They don't. They do gas.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah.
If you're out in the county, I don't know.
Right. Mark, do you know what?
No, it won't mark water lines. So it's gas, electric, telephone, cable.
Right. Okay. Yeah. So a general profile for a rain garden, it looks something like this. So you can do a string level before digging. If you have a little slope, and then this is the area, if the water's coming from this source here, then you want to build a berm across there, which can come out of the soil that you remove here, can be part of the berm. And then that will act as sort of a retaining wall, if you will, to maintain the water an area that's designated then as a capture point for water. But you can run a string and you can measure, there's this 6 inches here, but there are other ways to do it. So steps for soil drainage rate, dig a test hole 12 inches deep, about 6 inches in diameter, about like the size of a coffee can. Post hole digger works well. You can dig a little post hole down and then into the soil. Evaluate the soil texture. You can grab some of that, see whether it's sandy or whether it's clay. That'll give you some indication of what you might be prepared for in that particular location that you've selected. Determine desired ponding depth. Again, this goes to say how deep do you want it, how much water is coming off your roof, there's ways to compute how much roof area you might have and how much water is coming in during, a 1-inch rain. That can be determined. So you refill it, you fill it with water to a depth and let it drain, and you just put a ruler down there and you can just stabilize it and mark it, and over time, 12 hours or so, you can time it, and then you compute how much drainage you get per 24 hours. That's the idea behind this. There's all kinds of documents out there on how to take care of this. So you can compute the rate. Refill the hole with water and observe drainage rate. So once it's filled, you take that rate. And they give an example here, 12 inches of water. The water drains from the hole in 40 hours. The drainage filtration rate is 12 inches divided by 40 hours, 0.3 inches per hour. Record the drainage rate for the later comparison to the rates. There's charts out there that you can compare them with, your drainage rates and what they recommend. So those are all available on the internet. It's sometimes called a PERC test, percolation, or drainage rate. So if the percolation test fails, in other words, you don't get rapid enough perking of that water, you may have to get a filter bed media of some sort. And engineered sand-filled media can be added. And it's mainly made up of 85 to 88% by volume of sand. And I think that's what they put in out front here, didn't they? Yeah, this particular mix. So 8 to 12% fines, that's silt and clay. 3 to 5% organic matter, like composted yard waste and so forth. So there's some organic matter in it. This does support rooted plants, so plants will get well established in that mix. Moderate to high permeability, 1 to 2 inches per hour. So that's good. This drains really well. This is also what I have in my backyard, my grain garden, is this mix. Captures or removes, as I mentioned, nitrogen, phosphorus, toxic metals, and other pollutants. So plants, of course, would utilize nitrogen and phosphorus. Toxic metals and other pollutants are, this mulch layer becomes very critical because it takes care of a lot of the organic materials. So again, some rain gardens have perforated pipe. My rain garden is like this. We'll talk about it a little later. And then it also has access points above that you can go in and clean that out. So there's some tubing that comes up and is displayed. Now these are mainly for what we call bioretention basins. They're still a rain garden, but it's a special kind of rain garden in the sense that it has underground special drainage underneath and then a way to clean that out. So native plants run off pollutants while attracting songbirds and butterflies. So it looks like this coming directly off the roof, down the gutter. And then if you have quite a bit of slope to your topography, you may have to put in some sort of a gravel or river rock to slow down the flow so erosion doesn't occur. And most rain gardens have an overflow to them. So there's usually a point that if it gets up above the level that you want it, then it's going to overflow. And it's critical that that first 1 to 2 inches of rain is captured in the rain garden, and that will allow good filtration. If it rains more than that, if we have 3 or 4 inches of rain, it doesn't perk that fast, so you need a place for it to overflow. So that's always kind of in your design. Yes?
Jeff, where does it drain to?
Well, usually it's draining, if it's downhill, you'd build up the berm, and then you'd have a place where it would just overflow. A controlled area that would overflow and would go wherever the water in your area would go.
So your perforated drain at the bottom.
That perforated drain actually it comes either through the dam or out, and it drains down to the stream or wherever it's going to go. So that drain, if it's 2 to 3 inches of rain, that's not big enough to carry the water off, so you need an overflow. You've got to plan for an overflow in, because we get 3 or 4 inches of rain, and it takes, you know, two days maybe for it to perk. You got all this water coming in, so you've got to have plan for overflow usually in an area.
Does it go down to a water table?
Yes, it will. But in my case, our rain garden drains right into Branch, Gant Brook, or Branch, Gant Branch. So it's kind of all downhill, and I'll explain that when we show my rain garden to you. But native plants, I mentioned native plants as being the selection for the rain garden. Non-natives all have sort of shallow root systems. Lawns, for example, are just, you know, just a few inches below the soil level that they have soil. But you get something like nyebark, and it goes down 15 feet. Roots will penetrate that far. You've got black-eyed Susan, really fibrous branching root system that gives a lot of absorption, takes up a lot of water, and can can accumulate a lot of, take up a lot of phosphorus and nitrogen. So some grasses are very good, have very deep roots on them.
What's that first one called? I can't see.
Well, this is...
No, the deeper root.
Oh, this is nibark.
Nine bark,
N-I-N-E, bark, yeah. And it's a native. It's part of the buffer program. Anybody take part in the buffers program, the riparian buffer program? These are the stakes that they give you is from nibark, and they cut stakes about 3 feet long in the winter, and then you go out and drive those into the side of a bank before spring, and they eventually will root in that area. So you can kind of cut down on your erosion, particularly if you've got a sharp decline or it's a stream that's being eroded very, very, very heavily. Nine bark is a great one to use. And there are varieties that are, it's usually green-leaved, or you can get some that have reddish tinges to them. It's better to stay with the regular native nine bark. And it gets its name because it has kind of nine layers of bark on it that kind of foliates off. Oh. So it gets its name from the fact.
And then once they go like this?
They hang, well, that's probably Itea. Yes, sweet spire. That's another type.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Those I've
are.
Seen that one.
Oh yeah, that and it has white flowers on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's Itea.
Oh, okay.
The genus. Mulch layer, usually you use triple ground hardwood mulch, which is finer than the double mulch, because it kind of intertwines better and isn't carried off by a large amount of water that might flow into it. Put 2 to 3 inches of mulch in the layer. Maintains moisture in the soil media. Minimizes the growth of weeds, which is critical. Binds metal. So this is where the mulch comes in. It's critical to have this mulch piece because it binds the heavy metals. And it also binds oil grease from the runoff. So it's good to have a good layer of mulch and keep adding that to it each year, or maybe refresh that layer of mulch.
Is that mulch big pieces? Okay.
No, it's very, very shredded. It's very ground up, yes.
Oh,
so
see.
it's if you get the larger one, then that if you have a heavy rain, then it all floats to the top.
Oh, yeah.
If you've got an overflow, it's gone. So been there, done that. So maintenance is one of the things that you do have to follow up with maintenance. So pulling weeds, especially during that first year. You water 3 times a week until your plants are established in the rain garden, since they've been freshly planted. Weed, prune, and water as needed. Minimize the sediment flow into the garden. I had a problem with my rain garden with sediment coming in, and I had to put in special little splash areas where the water would drain in, and the flow rate would slow, and then it would percolate into to the rain garden. So there's always things you can't plan on that can crop up. Mulch annually, triple shredded hardwood, won't float away. And of course here, maintenance, we do have our built-in garden group, our team here. We have multiple teams that take care of the garden, so maintenance is easy. And there's one of them sitting right over here, two of them in fact here. And then we sometimes have major duty that has to occur, and Jim is here. We had the castor beans that were taking over. Here's the rain garden a year ago. So he's taking down the castor beans. So yes, there is some maintenance, but he luckily wasn't in here pruning anything here yet. So so any questions about that part of it? So what's a watershed? Simple definition, it's just the area of land that catches rain and snow that accumulates, drains, and seeps into marsh, stream, rivers, lakes, or groundwater. So it's usually a fairly large area. So here are the North Carolina river basins, and of course we have quite a few of them here. This is the one that we are involved in right here, Cape Fear River Basin. So this all flows to the coast. This all flows this direction, which is unusual when you think about it. So it flows this way. Doesn't go to the coast. But here's the area then. So we're located right about here in Burlington. And we have Hall River, Deep Little Alamance, and that's the Cape Fear Basin. So our water which we try to clean up here, ends up down here in the Cape Fear River Basin, along with Gen X. Everybody know about Gen X, the pollutant that's being produced? Yeah. So luckily they've stopped that, but it's been going on for years. So again, things you do upstream directly affect what goes on downstream.
And they're downstream, aren't they, Gen X?
Oh yeah, it's way down. Yeah, it's way down at the coast, which doesn't involve us, luckily. But
it's too bad.
We do everything here to try to clean our water before it gets into this river system. And
it seems like it's worse because it starts down low.
Yeah. So here's the watershed map again, showing our area. And these are some of the streams along. So pollution sources are all upstream. So everything flows from here down, part of Little Alamance. So the solution is additional residential rain garden. So hopefully that was the intent behind their campaign that the city started, was to get that there. So Little Alamance Creek Watershed Residential Rain Garden 2016 campaign. So a year ago, the Stormwater Department was composed of Chester Patterson, environmental specialist, and Michael Lane, field operations, and Danny Scales. Chester moved to Alabama in April. Michael Lane moved to Florida. So Danny, who's still kind of in training now, is the only person in the Stormwater Department. So again, I talked with Bob Patterson, who's the Director of Water Resources, and he indicates they are looking for replacements. So this campaign is on hold, as you might surmise. A limited number of funding opportunities are still available, according to Bob. So there's still funding available, but it's going to take a while to get the new people up to speed. They're going to review and compile the previous requests that have been made to them, and then restart the campaign. So that's kind of an overview of where they hope this is going to go in the future. So we live right in this area right here. So this is Gant Branch, which runs under Front Street, right at the Rockwood Extension. It comes on down, joins up Little Alamance here. But then we have Dye Branch, we have Coble Branch, and a lot of little branch streams that feed in. Along those basic streams, there's Danny Scales takes samples from those areas. There are 11 sites that are sampled. And that whole area has been considered being biologically impaired. And so all the sampling that they've done, the aquatic microinvertebrates that are indicator species, these are identified by the Clean Water Act of 72. They found that this stream was really limited in terms of what was going on. So there was a concerted effort to try to monitor this and address this issue. And some of this freshwater pollution that can occur, there are indicator species that they look for. So they collect these species. So animals found in water with low levels of oxygen, for example, look at these names: sludge worm, rat-tailed maggot, blood worm. Wow. Doesn't that speak of indicator species? Those are something to look for. So along the continuum of the river, things can of course change, and that's where the sampling is occurring. So they can pick up where these microinvertebrates are surviving or not surviving. But areas found with high levels of oxygen, you have the mayfly nymph. So if you got mayflies coming out, stonefly nymph, or freshwater shrimp, then those are indicators of good quality water. Mm. And here are some of them over here. You can see pictures of the some of them. But here's the clean water ones, mayfly. Moderate pollution here with these, the presence of these. So some of these, there's a sludge worm down here. So some are sensitive to water pollution. Some are tolerant to pollution. And that's why we have these indicator species, because some of them survive even though they're in sort of polluted water. And all members of the aquatic food web, and this is what they're trying to monitor in Little Alamance. Chemical testing of stream water quality is expensive if you had to go in and chemically test it all the time. But using the biological method of looking for these indicator species is much easier than that. So there are a lot of indicator plants too that are used to identify potential pollution. Lichens, for example, are a good example. If you have lichens on the tree bark, that's an indication of really good quality air. So over in Germany and Switzerland, where they had all the smelting going on and the smoke, the lichens disappeared. They were gone from the trees. So it's a good indicator species. So luckily, I've got lots of lichens growing on my sweet gum in the backyard. So biologically impaired, and this is all according to EPA. So Little Alamance Creek, including Gant Lake, which is no longer there, it's been drained. Mays Lake, which is still a lake. It's about 12.6 miles long, but from the source to Big Alamance Creek, so that's where it drains into the Big Alamance. But it's found that the benthos was poor. So again, it's checked every couple of years. So the assessment of water quality in North Carolina is required by that particular section, the Clean Water Act, and is to be reported on every 2 years. So that's a report that goes. So what they did, the city went ahead and in January 2015, the EPA approved what's called a Category 4B demonstration of Little Alamance Creek to remove the creek from the list. So this temporarily removed it, and they had basically a project in mind on how to correct what was going on in Little Alamance, and that they did. As a result of that, the City of Burlington, City of Graham, and North Carolina DOT worked with a consulting group, Allie Williams, Carmen, and King, and they have this website available, and you can get an update on what's going on Little Alamance out there. And all you do is do Little Alamance Creek, and it'll pop right up. It's also available off the City of Burlington's stormwater webpage. So if you go out City of Burlington, you'll find a link out there on Alamance, and they update that. So, and they also map the areas that have been they've been looking at. So it's got a lot of information. So their initials, it's AWCQ. You may see that on some documents, but it's an interesting site. I got some photos. Lake Jordan watershed, of course, that's where our basin, Cape Fear, all drains into, and here's Burlington right here. Lake Jordan down here. So that's the area that feeds directly into Lake Jordan. And of course, a lot of the Lake Jordan rules that I think we still have the $5 per month on our water bill, that is to take care of the problem that was reported to EPA. And it's a utility fee that we pay monthly. And the Lake Jordan rules, of course, continually each year kind of get relaxed because they don't want regulations on it. So so here are some of the existing rain gardens in the city. Our rain garden's right here. We're just right on Front Street. There's Gant Branch right there, comes in, Little Alamance. Then here's the Coronado Center right here with their rain basin. We have the new one over here at the extension office. So these are some of the projects. There's also one at Fairchild, which is not shown here at Park. So,
and farther edge.
Is it here?
Edge
there it is. Yeah, there's Fairchild. Yeah. Oh, here's the Alamance. I was looking at this one. This is ours up here, the extension office rain garden. So those are the product. They did put a small rain garden out at McIntosh, which I haven't seen lately, so I'm not sure what it's in. So these are some of the products of the Coronado Center Rain Garden, Fairchild, Lake McIntosh, Arbor Gate Rain Garden now, so that's good. So our rain garden is basically what we call a bioretention because we had about almost 1.3 acres above us that drains from 7 different homes. The roofs, the driveways, everything drains across and funnels across our yard. So the city figured that was a good option because it was going to clean up the water because the next step from our yard is in the Gant Branch. So it made perfect sense. And this is kind of what they're looking at, what they can get for the bang for their buck, and meet some of the EPA requirements for this demonstration project that they have. So we do have underground drainage that drains through the, goes through the dam. Here's the dam. So here's the inflow from the property above us, comes in, and they do have the sand-filled media in there. They went down about 18 inches. They put a layer of gravel in here and embedded the piping. We have stand-up pipes. There are four of them in the garden that they can access in case roots clog it or something gets clogged. They can clean that up. That hasn't happened to be done. It seems to be working just fine. Again, we're talking about evapotranspiration, so these plants do take up water and give off water. So this is our rain garden, second year or so. During the rain, and you can see there's an outlet point there. There's a couple down here. The dam is right here, and the city actually came in and packed this with clay to build up the dam. And all the water comes in from this side right here, so it flows in to the rain garden. And then the dam, the pipe runs under the dam, and then the outflow is down here, and then it goes right on to Gant Branch then from there. So that's kind of the setup there. This was taken in early spring. The selection of plants, working with my son, of course, I'm a beekeeper, so I like to have plants in the yard that are bee-friendly. So we have the dwarf witch alder, Prothangilia. We have black-eyed Susan in there, sweet pepper bush. There's nyebark. The flower on nyebark has a very, very nice kind of white flower. Here's the Virginia sweet spire over here. So we have, usually they're in five, so we did a cluster of grouping of the plants. So the beehives sit right back here, and Front Street is right out there. There's the back of our house. and this is the second year, so you can see this is a serviceberry tree here. That was what was flowering, just coming into flower here, serviceberry. And it's recommended for having its roots wet. Frothingillia, there's the iris, the yellow iris there. Here's the nyebark. I have a sort of this reddish nyebark in there. And then here again is where the drainage all comes in from this direction.
Is that shaded?
It is. This is a shade rain garden. Good point. It's a shade rain garden. It's partial shade, whereas the one out front here is full sun. So that's critical, and when you come to determine or ascertain what kind of plants do you want in your garden, do you want partial shade, full shade, sunny? So that helps in the selection of plants. So here you can see, this was taken in July, and you can see the yellow iris coming up here, nyebark. We have a buckeye. This is the red buckeye. It's planted right in the rain garden. It does really well in there. These are just coming out. This is the sweet pepper bush over here. Itea is right here. The sweet spire grouping there. And then the ferns. I've got lots of ferns in and around planted, and they do well in some areas with wet feet. So, and of course, since I like ferns, I do have a good place for ferns. This was taken on August the 30th.
What kind of this?
They have the...
Are they
ostrich? No, none of these are ostrich. This is the... what's the one?
Autumn fern?
Autumn fern, yeah. It's the reddish one. Yeah, it's the autumn fern. And this is Selaginella, which is the little Selaginella that's a creeping plant that grows attached mainly to like a ground cover. And then there's in here is the... sensitive fern is over here. In fact, I'll have a bunch of sensitive ferns when the plant sale comes up. I have about 12 sensitive ferns that I've potted from my yard, just potted. And then I have the ghost fern, which is a new one to the group. That'll be on sale coming up with the plant sale coming up. And I think there are handouts over there for the plant sale.
Are any of those ferns evergreen ferns?
This one, the autumn fern is in this area. It retains. And of course, our native fern, which I don't see it here, is the Christmas fern is a native. It does really well. It's evergreen. So,
okay.
Yeah, those two ferns are evergreen. This one, of course, is not a native, but it does so well here. It's beautiful. Yeah, does really well. Here's the Coronado Center bioretention area, and they have an overflow. So it's all downhill here. The inflow into this is over here, and the outflow, it either perks or it can outflow over through here. Once it gets deep enough, it'll just flow out there. So it then is siphoned off to the lower area. This is the other side of it. So here's the drainage area. And up here, the tennis courts over there, the aquatic center's back here. So that runs uphill to the Conodal Center. And if you haven't been over to the fragrance garden at the senior center, it's quite nice to just walk through there and visit. So,
question.
Yeah.
What kind of trees grow in that moist?
Well, those are maple. Red maple will do well in rooted. Willow oak, yeah, or willows. Willows will do well. You want to get the smaller willow. You don't want to get the big black willow because it just gets too big. But yeah, they do our recommendations. The red buckeye that I have flowers every year. We got it. It was our most expensive plant for the rain garden. It was about that high, just a stick. And now it has done really well in the rain garden. So birch, sure, river birch. Yep. In fact, there's birch in here. Birch and maple in there. Yep. So they have a nice little placard out there that you can read about bioretention. And they've got a picture of my rain garden right here, so which I shared with the city. So that's part of the deal, was I was to help educate, hopefully, the public on rain gardens. And
I like that.
Yeah.
I read that a few years ago.
Oh, did you?
Got me going. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, good. Yeah. So, and also made it on... I'll mention this now because on the handout that I gave you, there's a link to the current 2015 backyard rain garden for North Carolina, and the link is there. When you receive it, you can just click on the link and get that. So, and then there's a nice, really fairly good publication, Rain Gardens in South Carolina, which is really well done, a nice little booklet. And it's all in color. If you get on the PDF and download it, it's beautiful color photos on it. There are two presentations out there that I have the links to. It's Rain Garden Plant Selection, which is done by Charlotte Glenn and a group of her cohorts at Chatham Extension Office. Really well done presentation out there. It's a PDF. And then they had a second one on Rain Gardens 101 also. Very nice, very well done PowerPoint presentations, and they're linked on my handout there. So I recommend all four of these as possibilities. And then of course we have the Rain Gardens in the South, which is still available, written by NC State professors, and it's a good reference, the one we started with before we started our project. And then there's other books out there on creating rain gardens, so those are just up here for you to look at. Yeah, so this documentation is quite nice. And in fact, we ought to get something like that for our garden out here because we have a lot of people walking up, and I think it might be helpful. So, but anyway, I was going to tell you, the reason I pointed those out, Charlotte Glenn's on Rain Gardens 101 has a picture of my rain garden in there because it's obviously full of rainwater, so they needed something with rain in it.
Yeah,
so this is the Fairchild bioretention basin. Again, you can see the clean out points here. There's an overflow here. Water comes in off the drive. The parking lot here flows in. It gets slowed down. There's an inflow here from the soccer fields and an outflow down there, and it goes on down to the stream then there. No, this is Fairchild. This is out at the soccer fields at Fairchild.
Just off the road.
Yeah, it's just off the road.
What kind of bushes they have there?
Those are mainly grasses.
Grasses?
Yeah, they've got a lot of grasses they planted in there. So, and this was taken...
grasses don't do good with the rain.
But a lot of grasses do. They have those really deep root systems. Yeah, they do really well. So... Again, you'll find some grasses out here. When we do a walkthrough, we'll look at those out here. But Chris, in her selection of plants for our garden, didn't want anything tall. Because when you walk up, you want to be able to see the rest of the garden. So by design, she wanted everything either dwarf or low growing so that it wouldn't hide anything in the background. So that's why the selection of plants was good. And obviously, she's done a great job because
it's... Yeah, it's a small area, so
right,
a big area.
Exactly. Yep, grasses. Right, yep. And this was just, it had been recently mulched. And there's another piece. There are some of the shrubs in here. They have sweet pepper bush in there. They have river birch. So there are, and the more grasses here. So the grasses did really well out there.
Excuse me, the one that was on the left, you said that was sweet, that real feathery one on the left?
This one right here?
That's sweet pepper?
No, it's back here. Oh, it's a deciduous plant. Oh. Yeah, this is an evergreen of here.
Yeah,
that yep.
Like
yep. Yeah. Yeah, cedar, you're right.
Yeah.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Mm.
Oh, cedar does well on the rain?
Yeah, yeah.
Wow, I wouldn't think
so. So here's Arborgate Rain Garden. Wannabe.
Before,
that's right. So Mark initiated all of this with an email to me, December 30th, 2015. So it shows you how far out we've been working on this. So
that's here, Arborgate is here?
Yeah, it's Arborgate. This is out the front door. This is what it looked like before we put the rain garden in.
Oh, wow.
So he wanted to know, he said, from the photograph by Chris Stecker, he said, river runs through. Might this be a rain garden spot? Question mark. So obviously you can tell that there's ponding going on here and the general slope is in that direction toward the curb. And all this is coming off, of course, the roof. So I got permission from Mark to let's invite the city in since they might want to help us. So they helped out with the planning and providing the medium that went in, didn't they? Yep. So we sort of partnered with the city to do this. So here's an aerial view of the building. Here's, you can see where most of the water drains off here. You can see by the discoloration here of the roof. And where's Cynthia's office? What's right here?
Uh-huh.
where it has a leaky roof. So this was the area that was intended to make be a good place for the
Was
for
it
the
originally rain. All clay soil?
It's all clay here, isn't it? Yeah, yeah. So Arbor Gate was established, and they've amended the soils, and it's done pretty well. So here's the rainwater source. You see the bulk of it comes down here, and then it would come down here and drain out into here. So we thought, well, that might be a good area. So the city came over. They took a transit. Rather than using a string, they had some better equipment. So they actually did some measuring, looking for the slope and where the flow might be. And this was a way to try to ascertain where it would be best to put the garden. So this was on, I think, the coldest day we had back in, 2016? Yeah. And they came over and we laid it out. It was cold that day, so they were laying it out with a hose, and then once it's laid out, then they mark it off with paint, and you can see Mark had already, I think the red flag's there? Yeah, Mark had already called 811, so, because he knew there was a power line or power cable that ran under just behind it where they wanted to dig, so we got that marked off. But then they painted up here, and but it was a cold day that day. So here it is, ready, layout's completed. And you can see again the red flags, but there's sort of the pattern that they had to work with. They had added this over here to stop any erosion because it drips right off the roof there. There's no gutters. And again, 811 was called, so it's good. So, and most of the water then comes out here, so it would drain down if we had an overflow. That's the natural place for it to flow. Out of there. So on March the 9th, I gave a seminar on rain gardens, and many of you, I think, were here for that. I was holding this end of the hose, and Mark was at the other end controlling the water coming in, but he had already dug the places to test for drainage and percolation. So there are multiple holes here that were dug. And we fill them with water, and Mark, we watch it over time and realize it was getting pretty good perk. Isn't that right, Mark? Yeah, perk really well. But they decided to go a little deeper and go ahead and add the medium. So they took out that existing soil. Part of it was used in the berm that's out there now. So there was quite a gathering for that. So we were able to get that, at least that test run. And then Once you have the sort of layout of what you want, then I contacted my son, who did sort of an initial plan, just a suggestion. It was just a working draft. It wasn't meant to be the total design for the garden. But it did give a list of plants that were rain garden candidates, and Chris used that. Again, she's made a great selection because things are doing really well. She did get some of the plants that Greg had put on the list, but there are a lot of newer plants out there. So here's clethra, here's the hummingbird, this is the sweet pepper bush. There's some helianthus, and we've got, there's liatris, it's out there. We've got there's about five different members of the aster family that are planted in and around that rain garden.
So they want water?
Yeah, some of the asters, yeah. They're the member of the aster family. Uh-huh. We tried asters in our rain garden, and they didn't like it at all.
Oh.
We got the aster that was recommended, and it's just, now I think it's because it's shade. Required more light.
Yeah.
So I moved them out to an area where it was lighted, or more sunlight, and they seemed to be doing well. So here we begin the digging part, and we had Eddie and Pam Love, who have their own business, and they were contracted to dig out the soil, so they were able to do that. And here's the layout. So once it was dug, the berm is there. Here's the drainage area. You see already some water had already washed through, so the river rock has been extended into that area. But that was it back on June 23rd. And then here's planting day. And again, master gardeners, their team worked in, and these are the master gardeners who planted the 32 plants that Chris had gathered together to plant in there. Thank you all. And then Danny Scales was here also. He was part of this group and helped out. So he's the remaining stormwater person in the Water Resources Department now. I shared this picture with him, and he couldn't believe, how come I'm so much taller than the people? And even they're even standing on the curb. They may be short in stature, but they're heavy in work. And that's kind of the low res picture of what it looked like after the planting, and they put the mulch down. So they did the planting and put the mulch on, and they kind of started out like that. So here's June the 29th, 2017, when I took the picture. And you can see liatris here. You can see jopi back here. Stokes aster, and we'll talk about those. Here's the iris here. This is a willow leaf goldenrod that's coming up there. This is another view from the other side. So liatris flowering, jopi, and some of the grasses along the berm. So you have a berm, there are different kinds of plants you can put up on the berm that don't require, maybe do not like to have their roots in water. And here's the, again, this is on the 24th, I took this picture, so you can see how much it has grown and is filled in. You've got the goldenrod over here. This one is not yet flowered, but I'll show you what those flowers will look like. And here's the view from the other side, looking at it. Blue star here. Here's some of the grasses, fountain grass up here. We've got coleus back here outside the rain garden. Ruellia, which is the Mexican petunia. We'll talk a little bit about that. So here we'll just review quickly some of the plants. Now, I'm not going to talk much about this. That'll be on there for you to look at later, but I want to show the plants. So here's the clethra, the hummingbird variety, and it's finished flowering, so a lot of the seed has formed here, so it can produce seed. And so pollinators have been there. This is when it was in flower, so it has nice white flowers. Berry fragrant, has a beautiful fragrant odor to it. So when it's in flower,
which is that?
That's the clethra, that's the sweet pepper bush.
Oh, okay.
Yep, mm-hmm. And it's a native. So it's really quite nice to have, and they've really overtaken my rain garden, the whole back of it. And it does well in shade, so. And this is the one I have in my yard. Ruby Spice is the variety I have in mine, so it has a little color to it. And of course, you can see a lot of my girls are busy on there, so which I like to see. But bumblebees, butterflies, wasps all visit that plant. And here's the Stokes aster, which is quite a spectacular plant, does really well here. And again, it's a member of the aster family. You see the Asteraceae, so it's not an aster, but it belongs to that family.
That's a full sun.
Right? That's full sun, right. So flowers are quite spectacular. And of course, you love to see this. Mm-hmm. Pollinators are busy working there on the flowers, so quite nice. The willow leaf sunflower is just coming up. It's not in flower yet, but it's the variety Table Mountain, and you can see it here. It has very narrow leaves on it, and will flower hopefully later in September. But it's again another member of the aster family. all of the Helianthus, Saladagos are all members of that. This is what the flower will look like out there, so it should be spectacular when it's flowering. that's yet to come, so this is hopefully the future. Then we have Blue Star, this plant right here, Ansonia, and it has, it's again, it's a native, and when it flowers, it has these beautiful flowers on it. There's one growing right here at the gate where you walk out of the garden. It's not in flower now, but it's constantly having to be pruned back because it's it wants to leave its site. But it blocks the walkway, so we have to keep it trimmed out there. But it has spectacular sort of powdery blue flowers on it. Here's Short's goldenrod. That's in full flower out there now in the rain garden. It has, again, a member of the aster family.
Wow.
So, and of course, this time of year, the aster family takes over because bees are after asters, which begin to flower now. And that's sort of a small nectar flow that we as beekeepers look forward to, and our bees also look forward to it. So, this is the goldenrod, Short's goldenrod. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that's what the flowers look like. I didn't catch any pollinators on it that time. So, then we have White Star, one of the grasses that is planted right in the rain garden itself. Looks like this. So, it's really unusual. It's a sedge. It's a perennial, it has those kind of white flowers on them. And you can see this is, these have the these stigmas are sticking out here, so it's got its sex organs hanging out there in the wind. It's wind pollinated. It could be visited by bees to gather pollen, but of course there wouldn't be any, there was no nectar source here. But that's an interesting plant to have in there. Pink mooligrass, you've probably seen it around, that's planted out there now. Sort of has this color, but then in the future should look something like this.
Oh, wow.
So it's quite spectacular. And
how long does it take to get there?
That will hopefully turn when it flowers. The mooligrass will produce
it. Is that in the fall?
Yes, in the fall.
Oh,
right.
Okay.
Yep. Mm-hmm. In the fall. So it blooms pink to pinkish red. Spectacular. Fountain grass is another one. It's planted up on the berm out there. Again, it does really well. It's done really well here. Did a great job selecting the grasses that are growing here. This is the flower stalk when I took it earlier in the year. And again, it has its stigma. These little stigmas are all sticking out. It's wind pollinated. And you can see these little awns. These are like projections off of the flower itself. And it gives it that look. So if you pull one of those flowers off, you see the awn, this long structure that comes off the flower itself. So that gives it that kind of texture that you see. And of course, these grasses add a texture to the garden that you normally don't have with some of the other plants. Mexican petunia, it's out there flowering now. It's a broadleaf sort of stays evergreen, so it'll be interesting to see what happens this winter. It's not a native here. We have a North Carolina petunia. It's in the same genus, Relia, and it's all over my yard. It naturally seeds, but it has same color flowers. And there's a picture, if you walk out the front of the building, I have one of my pictures is up there of the pink-flowered Ruellia carolensis that we have in North Carolina. But here's what the flowers look like up close. They're sort of tubular.
Oh, pretty.
Yep, very nice. Yep. And it has this, there's narrow leaves on it.
Is that the Mexican one?
That's the Mexican. That's the Mexican. Yeah, these are all the Mexican ones. Yep. Unfortunately, in Florida, it's on the exotic plant list. It's one they don't, they have to control because it spreads really badly. Yep. So it's an invasive plant, or can be if you let it. So it's one to watch. Gay feather is another interesting one. Again, the aster family, again, has these spikes of flowers coming off of it. Again, it's bees are very interested in it, and bumblebees. And this is unusual in the sense that most plants in the flower stalk, the flowers in this case open from the top down. Yeah. So, which is unusual in most plants, but you can see these haven't even opened yet. So if you go back to this one, you can see these have all finished, and these are just opening down here. So yeah, very interesting plant. Another native does really well here. Louisiana iris, we think it's this species. We've been trying to run down the correct name for it, but it's a yellow, it's an iris, and we think, and again, we're not sure, but we think the color is this. It has not flowered this year, so there's a lot of vegetative growth out there, but no indications of flowers yet. My rain garden, I have a yellow iris, this particular iris, and flower, is that the one you have? Yeah. So it does really well, and of course, I like it because, one, it spreads, but I also like it because of this. The bees come in and they go down in underneath. You can't see it, but there's pollen all over her back. So they crawl down inside the flower and get nectar, and then pollen is carried. And do you have seed pods on yours?
I'm sorry?
Do you get seed pods forming on you? Yes. Yeah, well, pollinators have been there. So that's quite kind of nice to see. Joe pie weed is another one that does really well. It's a common weed here in North Carolina, ditches and so forth. There are varietal ones that are good. This is a short one, Baby Joe. And it's spectacular in terms of its flower. Again, Asteraceae, it's a member of the Aster family. And of course,
I saw a monarch on my Joe pie weed.
You what?
I saw a monarch.
Oh, did you? Oh, monarch? Oh, yeah, monarchs.
My Joe pie. I was
like, yeah, yellow swallowtail, eastern swallowtail will be all over it. Wasps. I get wasps and other bees, native bees all over it. Hoverflies. Yep, it's quite attractive to honeybees too. So, and again, this you can see all of the stigmas are sticking out here. So again, it's more or less wind pollinated, but it can be pollinated by bees. They pick up pollen and nectar from it. Common mistakes now in the gardens. One is installing in soils that lack the percolation rate. So that's critical to the whole step process when you decide, if you decide to put in a rain garden. Poor maintenance, weeding and pruning, so you need to keep up with it. That's one thing the city ran into with some of these big bioretention, was getting the people to keep it up, because that first year is critical, and you can just, weeds took over Fairchild very quickly, and they had a real fight trying to get it back under control. selecting plants that are too tall, so that's not the case of ours out here. I didn't care about mine because I wanted it to grow up and cover everything. It does limit your ability to get in and work among the plants, because once it fills in, which is okay, as long as it's still draining, it's fine. Use of fertilizer. Native species do not require a lot of fertilizer, so you don't need to use fertilizers on these plants. improper plant placement. Some drought, like this, we had our experience with our aster, our New England aster, didn't do well there at all. You need to make sure your selection. So it's an ongoing process as you plant into a rain garden. There'll be some success and some not successful. And you just relocate them or get a better plant. So it's easy to do. Improper location of the rain garden, water does not flow naturally to the site. So making sure you have an inflow of water correctly is critical. So some of the things here, I just talked about this publication. Now again, it's on my list that I have. And again, I'll be very happy to send out to anyone so you don't have to type in those long names. But I wanted you to have something in hand to remind you. Get a hold of Jeff and I'll send that to you. But this was redone February 2015. So it's new. It hasn't been changed a lot. And then this is that PDF I was talking about that was put out by Charlotte Glenn and her group. Bill Lord, you may have seen him on Almanac Gardener. And Wendy, I think, has been on there. But anyway, this is well done. It's a well done document. Flows very well. And so that's a good one to have, particularly if you want to go over what I talked about here. It goes into a little more detail. Rain garden plant selection. This is a really great one because it gives a lot of the rain garden plants that we talked about here, but also ones that I have in my rain garden, but we don't have in this one. Again, sun, partial shade, or shade is critical on which plants you select. But I highly recommend downloading these and having them available to look at because it's all in color. Here's the backyard rain garden. This is the North Carolina Cooperative Extension. I've got this link on the handout. So you can get out there, you can go in and stormwater. You have garden maintenance, stormwater, and your rain garden. So a lot of interesting links, plant selections there. So that's a good website to have access to. Then going native, this is a great website for selecting native plants and helping you sort of create your selection of plants that you might want to use. So again, that link is on there. And this is the Rain Garden book. How-to instruction has plant lists. It has design tips, so it has little drawings of some of the particular kidney-shaped rain garden you might have and the placement of plants you might want to select for it. Both both sun, shade are treated. And this is the best rain garden book I've seen. It's a guide, and it's for the state of Washington. But they have done a marvelous job. I think it's about 70 pages long, but it goes into all kinds of detail. Plant selection, you wouldn't want to use that for your plant selection here. But in terms of the techniques and how to address a rain garden, it is really well done. And it's available out there. It's a free PDF download. So again, that link is on there. Great source of information. Here's the Piedmont Triad Regional Council. And Smart Stormwater Smart is a part of that. And that link is on there also. But this takes you to their page. And Burlington is part of this council. We are members in there. So if you need some advice on is this a place for a good rain garden, you can contact these people and make arrangements. They'll come into your yard and give you suggestions and maybe even a slight design, but they don't do the heavy work. They're just there to advise you. But it's free of charge. They don't charge anything. And I first started with them in my yard 5 years ago. They came over, we walked through, and luckily that day it was pouring down rain. So they got to see firsthand what was going on in the yard, and they said, oh, absolutely. The city was along with me, so the city was there. So it was
good.
Yeah, smart. It's Stormwater Smart. You see it right here. Stormwater Smart should be on here. I think it's up here. It's on there. There it is.
Okay.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And on a big metropolitan area, the importance of rain gardens. This is Washington again. Western Washington University is part of this program. Their campaign kind of dwarfs what we're trying to do, but it's a similar thing. They've actually had their goal, 12,000 rain garden in the Puget Sound area. So all these yards that feed in the Puget Sound, they're trying to get rain gardens. To date, they have 3,822 rain gardens that they've helped get placed in that area. So, and of course, as you all know, Seattle and that part has lots of rain. So you don't have any problem. It's been fairly warm there recently, but anyway, this is a nice campaign. I thought, gee, what a contrast. 3,822 rain gardens, and they have it mapped out. You can go in and go into your neighborhood and see where rain gardens are located in your particular neighborhood in Seattle. So kind of interesting. Well, that does it for me, and we'll do a short walkthrough out front if you want, but I'll entertain any questions you might have now. Oh, good. And there's my information that's also on this handout, so you can have my email address. So again, you can just send a request to me, and I'll see that you get the PDF form of this, and once I get the PDF done of the presentation, I'll send that along too. So thank you all for coming.
Thank you.